Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for coming. I'm going to present the Btlejuice tool I've developed, and especially the man-in-the-middle attack it implements. So, just to start, I am Damien Cauquil, a French senior researcher at CERT-UBIK, which is a part of the digital security company, French company, and this company is owned by Econocom. Maybe some of you knows about it. But anyway, I started studying Bluetooth low energy security back in 2013, so it's quite a while. I've been testing stuff in the BLE field, and this is my main focus since then. So you can find me on Twitter. What we are going to talk about here in this talk is mainly the basic stuff in Bluetooth Classic, well, very, very shortly, and Bluetooth Low Energy, also called Bluetooth Smart. And I will also discuss the fact that Bluetooth Low Energy sniffing really sucks. I don't know if some of you perform some kind of sniffing with specific devices, like a Bluetooth or something like this. But it's really difficult in certain conditions to get valid data or something what is something very useful from these tools. And we will go through the man-in-the-middle attack I designed and the tool associated with it, that I called Btlejuice. Well, a great reference to a movie. And we will end the talk with live demos. So I spent all the morning to pray the demo gods, of course, in order to have all the demo that went well. But in fact, since there is a lot of people here, maybe there will be some interferences with your devices. And I will show you with my tool that every device I can identify with this tool, and maybe some problems with it if there are too much trackers or something like this available on it. So first of all, the Bluetooth Smart 101. So you are all aware of Bluetooth Classic, which has been very, very used the last years. But they defined in the Bluetooth specifications the Bluetooth Low Energy protocol, which is a not so new protocol, but it has been widely deployed since 2 years on many devices. So it's a very, very, very common protocol now, and it's implemented in a lot of devices. And the Bluetooth Smart protocol was designed in order to be implemented in in embedded devices. In fact, in devices that requires low power and with all the capability of Bluetooth. So it's widely used. If you search on the internet about Bluetooth Smart enabled devices, you will find a lot of them. And some of them are very, very freaky. You have the Smart Mattress. Doesn't show very well here, but this is a kind of device you can put under your mattress. And that device monitors the movement of the mattress. So I guess you see what we can do with this kind of stuff. Well, anyway, there is also the Smart Diapers. It's a diaper that tweets when your baby pees. Also a very, very common need. And just to conclude, some kind of security stuff like smart alarms or even smart dogs or padlocks. I have some of them here to demonstrate. So I've heard about another talk at DEF CON about pointing smart dogs. So can be maybe the same in a way, but anyway. The Bluetooth stack is divided in two because there is a traditional model called the Bluetooth Smart Ready. But basically, the lower protocols are the same from the physical layer to the L2 cap, with some changes, of course, between it. But the upper layers are totally different between Bluetooth Classic and Bluetooth Low Energy. Bluetooth Smart provides a lot of features, or new features. So, not so new. The frequency hopping spread spectrum mechanism is still used in Bluetooth Smart to avoid the interferences between between devices. It also supports encrypted communication through bonding. So if you create a bond between your mobile application, your smartphone, and some BLE-enabled device, it secures the communication. This is covered by the SMP, the Security Manager Protocol. So we'll cover this later. One of the most important thing about Bluetooth Smart is the fact that we are not creating sockets to communicate with device, but basically used what they call services and characteristics. So you have basically a device that provides one, two, three, or more services, and for each service provides one or more characteristics. You can see this like some kind of registers. You can write in it and read from to put data on the device and get data from the device. And this this communication is covered by the GAP and GAT layer of the protocol. So it's that's pretty cool. I will not go too deep in the description of these protocols. So if you guys want to more information, you can read the Bluetooth specifications. Good luck. But maybe very useful to understand how things works with this kind of stuff. One more thing about Bluetooth Smart. Bluetooth Smart devices, for most of them, accepts only one connection at a time. The specifications says that normally a device may be able to accept more than one connection, but in fact, in most of all devices, a single connection is supported. So this is important for the attack. The frequency hopping spread spectrum is a feature you may already know. It's basically a way to avoid interferences between devices, since all the devices use the 2.4 gigahertz bandwidth. So this is quite not new, but it's still present in the Bluetooth Smart protocol. So basically, when you're using some sniffer, it's very difficult to get valid data because you have to sniff the synchronization step that it's performed first to be able to follow the same hops and get data from it. So basically, when you are in a laboratory environment, this is perfect. You have everything you need for the cages and so on. But in the wild, this is very difficult to perform. I gave a talk last year at the Chaos Communication Camp in Germany. And I plan to make a demo about BLE sniffing right on stage. This year, they had the great idea to provide all the attendees with some kind of RQRF badge. some of you got one. Basically, I was in front of thousands of people with an RQRF. And this badge communicates through the 2.4 gigahertz band. And it was very difficult to perform a valid capture of BLE data, of course. So this is difficult to sniff. To prove it, I just found this on Twitter. It's a Sammy Camcar posting a picture of what he called the new Faraday cache technology from IKEA. It's a way to do this. It works in a way, but you can also use a microwave oven. basically, it's much more MacGyver style, but it's may be used to get accurate data from BLE sniffing. At Digital Security, we have the professional Faraday cage that looks like this, but it costs a lot, many thousands of euros or dollars, and it's not affordable for a single researcher. Some information about the SMP, Security Manager Protocol. I told you that the Bluetooth Smart implements some kind of encryption. So between a mobile smartphone and a device, we can have we can set up an encryption and have an encrypted communication. So this is performed this way. When you are connecting your smartphone to the device, bounding your smartphone to a device, send a pairing request, basically telling the device what kind of bonding you support. So if you read the specifications, Bluetooth specifications, there are many of them. The first one is just works, so no pin code, and it just works, like the its name said. And you can also provide a pin code, and the other one is the OOB bounding, which requires a net of band communication mean to provide both the device and smartphone with bounding information. Then they agree on what is called a SDK, a short-term key, used to encrypt the following step. And during this following step, the long-term key is provided to the device, and also some information about identity and revocation. So this can be used to check if the device that uses encryption is a valid one. And of course, to encrypt all the further communication. So again, this is a problem when we want to sniff some BLE communication. But many security researchers found a way to bypass it through a tool called Crackily. You have also BTPin, which is a tool that performs the same attack. So basically, you sniff all the traffic from between a smartphone and a device, and then you break the encryption once you get all the data. So keys can be recovered this way. So this is basically how we perform security, Bluetooth smart security assessments since then, by using mainly sniffing to guess all the devices in the smartphone that commit exchange data and what is the data exchange between them. So many things to tell about it. First of all, that is that few devices use encryption. So if you buy many BLE-enabled devices, few of them use bonding. And this is very interesting because bonding provides a way to encrypt communication, but also to perform strong authentication. So almost all devices are not strongly authenticated. And this is a problem. Some of them perform authentication, but only on the BD address, which is basically a MAC address of the Bluetooth device. So sniffing attacks are difficult to perform, but there are many weaknesses, non-weaknesses, in the devices we want to test. And here comes the man-in-the-middle attack. It was an attack which was theoretical, and it was mentioned by many security researchers, especially some researchers who presented here at DEF CON in precedent editions. So, it's not an easy attack to set up, but as you're going to see, we managed to get it working on many devices. Why BTLE sniffing sucks? First, because of the devices you need to perform sniffing. You are maybe aware of the UBATUS, which is a USB adapter you can plug in your computer that provides many ways to get information. So it performs the synchronization step and follow every ops to get information from the BLE exchange. Some of you have used the Adafruit Bluefruit Sniffer. Yeah, which works. It's a very awesome tool. The only non-limitation is that it creates some non-standard pickup files. So it's quite difficult to analyze the exchange between two devices. So it's cheaper than the Ubuntu, but it has a drawback, as you have to use some specific plugins for Wireshark in order to some dissectors to be able to analyze what data is exchanged and what operations are made on the GAT stack. Btproxy, well-known tool used for Bluetooth Classic. Obviously, they do not plan to work on Bluetooth low energy. It works perfectly for Bluetooth Classic, but it has absolutely nothing to provide for Bluetooth low energy. So, I did not modify Btproxy, but. So basically, when you face encryption, the strategy, the attack strategy, is to sniff first and then decrypt. So you cannot interact, you cannot modify on the fly the data. You can only monitor what is exchanged between two devices. So it's a pain in the ass to get something sniffing and to get information by sniffing between two BTLE-enabled devices. So man in the middle is a way to bypass all of these limitations. It's very, very simple to set up on paper, but to get it working on my computer, it was a lot difficult. So basically, how can we perform some kind of man in the middle using some on Bluetooth Smart? First of all, we set up what I call a proxy, which is the central here. The central is simply a kind of service that will connect to a Bluetooth Smart device. So using the classic BT4 adapter, you can plug in with some kind of USB. It also works with your embedded adapter in your laptop, so it's very easy to perform. And this central communicates with the dummy device. This dummy device, it's again a service that will create or simulate a real BTLE device with the exact same characteristics that the one we are going to interact with. So first, we connect to the device. Then we create this dummy device, which is in fact a clone of the first one, with the exact same services and characteristics and so on. And then we wait for a connection to the dummy device from a smartphone, mobile application, and so on. And then we forward the information between the smartphone and the target device in a bidirectional way. So it's quite straightforward to set up on paper. It's the basics of man in the middle and proxy. So why not create a tool that allows people to do the same attack very easily? This is very easy to write it on paper, but to do it, it was quite difficult. But in fact, there are many libraries, well-known libraries called Noble and Blino, and these libraries were developed by Sandy Mystery and put on GitHub, so it's totally open source. Noble is in charge of all the connection operations. So when you want to connect to a Bluetooth device, a Bluetooth smart device, you can use it and perform all the discovery and the interaction with the device. Blino is very good to create a dummy device. You can create peripherals, Bluetooth smart peripherals, and provide services and characteristics. So you have, in one hand, Noble, which provides all the stuff to connect to a target device. And in other hand, you have Blino, library allowing all the stuff to, providing all the stuff to create and simulate a device. So we have everything to we need to perform this man-in-the-middle attack. This man-in-the-middle attack relies on standard BT4 adapters. There is no expensive hardware to buy, so it's very interesting. The communication between the dummy device and the proxy is made through web sockets. So this is again some kind of standard that can be used to communicate with a web browser or something like this. So this can be interesting, and it also supports bonding. For specific Linux kernel configurations, so you have to use a version of Linux kernel 4.x, 4.2, or so on, and a specific version of BlueZid. So the fact this attack relies on BlueZid version 5, it may cause problem on some distro, because the BlueZid file is not deployed widely on many distros. So if you are using Debian, for instance, this is a BlueZid 4 by default. And if you are using Ubuntu, it's a BlueZid 5. So you can upgrade BlueZid if you want, but it's up to you to do it well in order not to put a mess on the system. The architecture is the following. So we have the proxy using Noble to connect to the target device. And the core CS service, which uses Blinu to create a dummy device. So we are creating a fake device. The core and proxy communicates with WebSocket. And the core service also provides a web interface, which is basically a burp-like interface, allowing the user to see what happens in the Bluetooth smart communication and also to interact with the device. I will demonstrate it later. And I also provide bindings for Python and Node.js. But I had a surprise yesterday. I got an email from someone telling me, hey, I made the same tool and presented it at Black Hat. Wow. He's just here. So I told him, yeah, let's meet. Let's discuss about it, about our tools. Let's see what we did and what we did differently. Obviously. But in fact, it gave me more information in this email, and it was also based on the same technologies. Wow. So, this is the exact same setup that he designed. And this is quite interesting because it means I did the right way what I wanted to do. His tool is called Gatak or Gataker, and there is a website gatak.io which was presented at with a cool logo. Yeah. obviously, this tool implements more tricks about Noble and Blinu. This guy modified Blinu and Noble libraries to get it working better. So he improved these libraries to do the man-in-the-middle attack. So when I started my development, I didn't want to modify these libraries because I wanted to be easily stable through NPM or something like this. So, So this other tool exists, which have many differences between mine, and his approach is a bit different from the attack strategy. We'll see this later. So hopefully, I thought I had enough time to put it on NPM. I was quite busy yesterday, stressing with this tool I was not aware of before writing this slide. So it took me some time. I've set up all the GitHub. I will give all the URLs later, but all the code is already open source and available. And in fact, I will publish it on NPM right after this talk with the slides. So it will be available through NPM.
Did you reserve the name on NPM?
What? You have to reserve a name on NPM? Nope. Be kind, guys. Well, maybe the name will change on NPM, so it depends on the availability. Well, that's what we call a fail. Yeah, I see. Anyway, the idea was to provide an easy setup through NPM. Also for the bindings through NPM and PyPI. The web UI is user interface is very basic and provides all the information you need. It sadly uses the XZ notation designed by Angel Batonis. I don't know if you know this guy. I think he has already presented to DEFCON. We presented to DEFCON many years ago. So this is a mix of eggs and ASCII. And this is a very, it was useful in my web interface because I wanted to see the strings pop up on the interface as well as the eggs. So it was a compromise I made to get it working and to get nice demos later. So this is not a big deal. The features. This Btlejuice tool provides a kind of monitor on navigate operations and data exchange between different devices. It is designed like so full features as Burp, but it's basically the same idea behind Burp. So I mean, you may be able, you can use this tool to perform on the fly data modification. You can put some hooks. I will demonstrate it later with the interface, but it's quite easy to use. And you can also do some replay attacks and replay some operations sniffed. There are bindings for Python 2, Python 3, and Node.js, intended to be used very easily and communicate with the rest. The bindings are not related to the web interface. You can use it in command line, standalone. There's no problem. The requirements. You need a two-machine setup to get it working. It's better than making Blinu and Noble working on the same machine. It's very difficult at this time to... It's possible, but it's difficult. I didn't manage to get it working with... lucky you. So, as I said, yes, to have some improvements. Well, the best is by using a virtual machine. So this is the setup I have here to make my all my demos. And you only need two Bluetooth 4 adapters. Looks like this. If you can find some CSR adapters, this is good to go. Because these adapters provide a way to modify the MAC address or BD address of it. So you can spoof the MAC address. And of course, Node to make it to get it running. So let's see all of this. So this is the web interface running on the machine. So to get it working, I have to start a proxy on the virtual machine and to start the core service on mine. Let's do it like this. Don't know if it's okay. Sound good? So first of all, I start the proxy on this virtual machine. Then I make sure the Bluetooth service is down because there was some problem sometimes with it. It's okay. I have a Bluetooth adapter up and running. So let's go. I'm starting the interface, and obviously this is not a good IP address. So here it is. I can sniff for devices. As I said, there are a lot of them, as you can see. Well, this is not a problem. I'm going to use this device, which is a BLE tracker available in many stores. Just to see if we can impersonate this. Well, it's going to be a challenge because should be this one. I have many of them right me, so picking the good one is always a problem. So basically, the proxy. What I'm going to take the mic. The proxy connects to the device, the target device, perform all the discovery, and then communicates with my core service. And this core service creates a dummy device with the exact same information. So if I use my smartphone to discover this this device and communicate with it, I will be able to intercept all the information. Let's use it. So this is my smartphone, my real smartphone. So I'm going to launch a BTL scanner. Connect to the simulated device, the dummy device, and everything. If everything goes well, here it is. Of course, you have a notification here saying that the dummy device accepted the connection from my smartphone, so it's good. And here the connection information. So I'm going to read a characteristic from this device. We have two of them here. The first one should return the version of the firmware of the world, 0106. And the second one, the a kind of timestamp, a date, and when the firmware was compiled or built. So this is quite interesting. But if you go back to the web interface, everything has been logged, and you can use it. Furthermore, we can put hooks on this. Like if I try again to read the date, I will be notified on the web interface, and I can modify the data that will be sent to the mobile application. So just have a look. I'm asking for this information. So pops here, set, modify the year. And if you look at the information display here, you have 2016 instead of 2015. So it's very easy to modify this. And if you want to remove the hook, just right-click, disable hook, and that's it. There is another button here. This button enables global interception. So for every operation, you will be notified and you can choose to perform the read, perform the write, or dismiss it. So you can easily modify the behavior of a device, and you also can tamper with the data exchange between two devices. It's also easy to perform fuzzing, a manual fuzzing with it, because we have some kind of replay attacks like this. We can perform some read in by using this just to prove this is working. I removed the previous data. But in fact, we can get information from the device, can read whenever you want and whatever you want. You can write whenever you want and whatever you want. So you can interact with the device, even with the mobile application is connected to it. So it's quite interesting to try to find vulnerabilities or maybe glitches in this device. And we also have some kind of notification. I don't know if Mitm device I have it here, but it's also supports notification. You can decide to forward or dismiss notification to perform an attack, say. So the benefits of this system is that it works with any Bluetooth 4 adapters. You can use any CSR compatible device adapter, or even your embedded Broadcom Bluetooth adapter. It's working. You can intercept every GET operation, notification, write or read, and you can, it supports also supports bounding encryption on a newer version of BlueZ and Linux kernel. So if your mobile application tries to create a bound between the simulated device and the mobile application, this is possible. You can do it, and this is supported by Blino, sorry, the Node.js library. It's also compatible with tests made with a firewall cage like we do at digital security, because since you need two machines to perform this man-in-the-middle attack, you can put a machine, say a Raspberry Pi, for instance, in the Faraday cage, and another Raspberry Pi outside to advertise the same device. So it's compatible with this kind of test. And Bluetooth device address spoofing is also possible. Because of some features of the Bluetooth Smart protocol. Creating the perfect dummy. When we want to clone and make a real clone of a device, we want to use the same address, the same MAC address for the device, and want to provide the device with the exact same characteristic and service. So I will show you some tricks I found to create a perfect clone by abusing some characteristics of the Bluetooth specification. So first of all, we connect to the target device. Since the device only supports one active connection, there is no more advertisement. Each Bluetooth smart device advertises itself, specifying some manufacturer data and so on. Once we are connected to it, it doesn't advertise anymore. So it's not visible from a smartphone or mobile application. And also, frequency hopping is active. So that means the Bluetooth device hops from channel to channel. And it's the frequency hopping system has been designed to avoid interferences. That means we can set up another Bluetooth adapter with the exact same address, advertising all the information about some kind of device, and it won't interfere with the active connection we have with the device. So this is it's possible to create another device with the same configuration, same services, same characteristic and Bluetooth address than the original one, while keeping the original one busy. So this is possible to create the perfect dummy. The bindings in Python provide some classes you can use to perform some operation and some modification of the data. You have many callbacks you can use, and it's quite easy to set up an application. I will demonstrate data many attacks using Python bindings and Node.js bindings. So it's easy. The code on GitHub has some documentation inside, and you can read the documentation. Everything is explained on GitHub about how to create these kind of applications. So these bindings require the core and proxy to be running in order to perform the man-in-the-middle. We have the same in Node.js. And of course, we can perform on-the-fly data modification. So here is an example of a battery service hooked by the Btlejuice proxy. And in the unbefore read callback, we modify the information returned by the proxy. If you read the code for a given service, 18OF, and a given characteristics, 2819, we modify the battery level and force the response. That means the read operation is never forwarded to the target device. We answer, we provide the answer to this operation. So this is pretty interesting. And of course, the unbefore callback raise hook force response operation that cause a dismiss. So there is no more subscription possible for notification. So this may be interesting in various attacks. Anyway, there are some limitations with this tool, because Noble does not support long writes. If you try to write more than 22 bytes in a characteristic, it hangs all the adapter and all the stuff. So it's a drawback I found. I didn't try yet the Gattaca tool, but since this tool performs low level reads and writes, maybe it's not impacted by this. I don't know. Yeah. We'll find out later, right after the talk. This is a problem I noticed while testing my tool. There is also an induced latency. There is a delay caused by the communication process. So since we are communicating through BTLE, then everything goes through WebSockets, and then back to BTLE. It induces some delay, and this can be detected by a device to determine if a man-in-the-middle attack is in progress. And sometimes it may be very tricky to intercept the communication between a device and the smartphone because of the device itself. Sometimes the device only stays up or advertises itself for a very short amount of time. So you have a very short window to communicate with the device and perform your attack. So let's demonstrate this this framework. I will start with this device, which is a BLE-enabled robot. I don't know if some of you guys have this device. So it's not very common, but a Chinese one, very widespread. So I will put it on. So yeah, make some sound. I don't know if. It's pretty cool. This robot is like a gyropod, and you just put it on the floor, and so it stands. I don't know if I can put it right here. Say. Doesn't make sense. Don't fall. Yeah, sounds good. I'm going to create a man in the middle proxy with this, and maybe on the table, yeah. Yeah, sounds better. Well, we'll see. So this device advertises itself. This is a Huawei MIP. And we are going to create a proxy with all of this. So the proxy is configured and ready to relay. So normally I will be able to communicate with my with my smartphone. So let's see if everything goes well. So I'll start the application. Sorry, because there's a drawback with the previous test, but anyway. So I tried to go tonight to grab this slide, which is a problem we experienced when designing the This is a problem when you have a lot of devices in the room.
Oh, yeah. That's not me.
Oh, that should be good. So here it is, and a lot of other devices detected.
Oh.
Damn.
I saw it working half an hour ago. So.
No, that's good.
That's not me.
Damn, demigod. Yeah. I got it working. It's connected on my dummy device. Hopefully, it will perform some GUT operations, read and write. Here it is. And the fun fact is, the designers of this robot included many sounds in it. You heard one of them. I'm going to be very quick, but in fact, this is this line that causes the sound to be played on the robot. And I started some kind of replay to see if there were many sounds on it, and if I can make some nice sounds with it. So first of all, I'm going to pick the second sound of the bank, and let you hear the sound. And yeah, sounds like a test beep put on it. Wait, there's more. Because the developers had a great idea. Let me play the third sound on the robot. Sorry, disconnected. Lucky me. I'll do it again. Holy crap. Same problem. Well, breaks everything. It was awesome. UX. And you're right. It's I have some improvements to make to. what a pity. I'm going to. What's the thing? Dishboard. Is it up again? Yeah. This is very effective. Oh shit. demo. We spend 1 minute more to see if I can get it working, but anyway. Too much devices. Maybe. Good. Yeah. No, it's not. Wait a bit. So, here it is. So, third sound is the following. Oh! Well, forget about it. There are many sounds that can be played this way. Sad, it was a sound of burp. It's anyway. So, I designed another attack on this robot that performs some kind of modification on the fly, data modification. So I modified the left and the right command just to invert all this command. So if you ask the robot to turn right, it turns left and so on. Well, it's pretty useless, but just to show you how it's done. So it's set up a proxy automatically, and if I take my remote control here on my phone and I ask the robot to go forward or backward. All the commands are inverted. So if someone wants to try it and drive the robot without making it fall off the table, of course. Yeah, it works perfectly again. Oh, shit. Well, let's forget about this robot. This is crap. But in fact, you saw it working with the correct interception. So the demo here pretty difficult to perform because of the number of devices. And this normally the frequency hopping spectrum system is designed to avoid interferences. But with the Bluetooth smart protocol, this sometimes happens. Well, anyway, back to the presentation. So there are no limitations about it. I made a lot of tests on my test devices, which are some kind of gables, which is a tracker, a WSTKey, another tracker, Master Lock 4400D, which is this kind of smart lock, last one provided by Master Lock, and also another padlock. I shouldn't give the name because it's very lame and it's weak. But this kind of padlock has some problems too. We are going to see what these problems are by using the framework. And last year, I presented at various cons my research about a specific smart lock, and I will give some feedback about its security and what can be done with this kind of tool. So first of all, the gables. This is the one I used for my first demonstration using some kind of red. And this tracker has absolutely no bonding. So you can create a perfect dummy with the exact same MAC address and so on. And it works perfectly with a proxy. There is absolutely no strong authentication, so it's very easy to spoof or to create an exact same gables. Just to give more information about the gables, this is a tracker. So your phone is normally connected 24/7 on it. So you should need to disconnect the gables before performing the man-in-the-middle attack. So this is not a really critical threat for this tracker. But anyone may make these gables beeps because it's you only need to write a specific value in the characteristics. But I found a denial of service attack on it. There is a denial of service vulnerability that can be used to render the gables down. And I found it by testing this tool, especially by testing the replay feature. So there is something that can be done. I will try to demo the gables light and the denial of service if more still demo goes. Since I'm very lucky for this for this talk. Oh yeah. I created a fake gables on my computer. I'm going to connect it with the correct application on this, and if everything works fine, you will see what happens on this screen. But it's sometimes a bit messy, but. So here it is. To add it to my smartphone. Sounds like it was already added. It's my smartphone connected to, or maybe someone connected to this gables too. I don't know if some of you have this application installed. definitely the demos are completely very difficult to perform here in live. So let's continue with the rest. So get this line, the bonding. There is the whiskey key. This one has bonding used, so it can provide strong authentication. And the tag is declared lost when connection is lost, so it's pretty cool. Other devices, the Master Lock 4400, I made a lot of tests with it, but I wasn't able to forward the read and write operations to it, so there is pretty no vulnerability in it, so can be we'll find out, yeah, but maybe for another talk. let's see. So it's available a short amount of time, so it's you have to be very quick to interact with this padlock, smart padlock, to perform all of these attacks. And also, I found another padlock, so I won't give the name, this one, that can be used to, if you set up a man-in-the-middle attack, you will find that the pin code used by the application is stored and exchanged in CloudTech. So it's no big deal to get the pin code, and through Bluetooth MAC address duplicating, it's very easy to create a fake lock and get it working. I will show you with the I need to play the demo goes again because still then only one demo works. But if I am able to create a fake device, this would be possible. So first. Here my smartphone again. So this device shows up when you push the button. So you have to push I have to push the button on the padlock to make it appear. So here it is. I'm going to create a perfect clone, not so perfect because the MAC address is not faked or spoofed, but here it is. I'm launching the normal application. So this lock has already been registered in my application. So my application discovered the available devices, connects to this smart lock. Since we created a quite perfect dummy, and I can ask the application to unlock the lock, and here it is. If you look at the web interface, I intercepted everything exchanged between my smartphone and the lock, and the default password on this lock is 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8, which is very, very complex. But in fact, if you look at the data captured here, you can see this one. So the exe format is not very perfect to see it here, but it's 12 and character 4 VX. If you put it in X, this gives you the pin code. So basically, what an attacker can do with this is set up a man-in-the-middle attack, wait for the owner of the lock to unlock this his lock, but obviously the smartphone will connect to the spoofed, here our fake lock, our dummy device. We intercept the pin code by using this attack, and the beauty of this attack and of this device is that this pin code to be able to add this lock to your application, because there is no bonding and no strong authentication. There is no information put by the mobile application into the lock to say that this lock belongs to this user or to this phone. And this is quite interesting to see. So once you have the pin code, you can interact with the lock and unlock it without any problem. So this is not so cool in terms of security, but it shows that many of these locks are very poorly designed. And this can be revealed by the Mandy-Media attack and Btlejuice in particular. So for this padlock, everything was sent in plain text. Authentication is based on the Bluetooth address, the Bluetooth device address. I showed that it was possible to fake this this Bluetooth address. So this is not a big deal to get a perfect clone of this padlock. And it stays active once a client is connected. And it stays in, active, enabled, a very long time. Once you get connected to this padlock, it can take 4, 5, 6 minutes for the padlock to shut down the Bluetooth interface, so Bluetooth service. So this is very, very very easy to create, to perform a Mandy-Media attack. If you compare this padlock to the master lock, which stays active only for, say, 10 or 12 seconds max, this is very, this is easier to assess. So the master lock is pretty good with a strong authentication, but the padlock is not. We can do interception at interception and replay attacks on this padlock with absolutely no problem, like on the gobless. And the smart lock, I'm not allowed to give the name of the vendor, but this smart lock was planned to be widespread in Europe and France in particular, and all the data was transmitted. Some of them unencrypted, especially the logs of the smart locks stored in the smart lock. And authentication was based sometimes on the advertisement data. You can fake a lock without having to spoof the Bluetooth device address. Mobile application find the lock by looking at the data advertised on the Bluetooth Smart protocol. So it's very easy to create a clone of it without cloning the Bluetooth address. And also no bonding was required, so you can just create it and spoof the device without absolutely no problem. The fun part of it is that the unlock and lock operations were based on the AES 128-bit military-grade encryption. I found that there were some problems with four more bytes they used to XOR something, and implementations. Is very implementation of an encryption algorithm is very important. So I found many flaws in it with this cryptographic approach. So basically, this smart lock was authenticated only on the data advertised at the Bluetooth smart layer. So it was very easy to create a fake one. And of course, this smart lock was vulnerable to interception and replay attacks. So I was able to open it, close it, steal some authentication tokens and some tokens used to lock or unlock this smart lock. To sum it up, Btlejuice can be seen as a security tool to assess the security of various devices. So it's maybe useful to determine device behavior, to allow data sniffing, and also manipulation. As I show you, the web interface has some features for replay attacks for data visualization. And you can do replay attacks, and this tool supports bonding, since the Blino library supports bonding. It can also be seen as an attack tool for bad guys, since it can bypass all the authentication based on Bluetooth device address and can be instrumented to automate attacks. Yes, I provide bindings for further usages for the tools if you guys want to base an attack or create a new an exploit based on Btlejuice. This is possible through the bindings, and it doesn't require specific hardware, but at least two machines or a virtual machine to to have this working. There is also no limitations due to Noble and Blino implementations and limitations. So some of these limitations have been solved by the Gattaker tool and by its author. And he found some tricks to cope with the problems I had with these libraries in particular. So future work, improve Btlejuice proxy reliability, and maybe see with the author of Gattaker if we can do something. Yeah, and take the best of these two tools, maybe, because the decision is not up to me, but yeah, we'll see. And also improve the user interfaces and bindings, because they are very, very basics at the moment. I did not take time to implement the other features I wanted to implement on it. So I have more work to do with the interface, and I will implement other features very soon, just to provide you with a good tool. And of course, we need more testing, more and more testing, because it took 6 months to develop this tool, and we tested it at Digital Security, but we were only 3 persons using this tool, and we need more testers. So if you're interested in this tool, its approach, and what can be performed what attacks can be performed with it, feel free to test it and to get it. So. The main code is located here, so datgatem.com, digital security with the capital D, capital S, and Btlejuice. There is an introduction on how to set it up, or install it. You can use basically this repository until I publish it on NPM. if the name is available, of course. But anyway, this is the code is here. The bindings also.
I will publish all of this with the Python bindings.
So all the bindings with a lot of example code, how to use it, how to connect to it, how to set up an attack and mend the middle and so on. So feel free to try it. Is there any question about this tool? Yeah? By using a CSR VT adapter. This is a Cambridge Silicon Radio adapter which implements a vendor command that can be used to specify the MAC address. It was previously done by some people. So there is a tool called BDADDR, that can be used to spoof the Bluetooth device address with it. Yeah, it's a part of Blues. If you install the Blues library, it's provided by this this library. Yeah.
What platform?
Currently, I run it on Ubuntu, but I got it working on Debian, and it should work on most of the recent distribution that use Blues libraries version 5 and more, and Linux kernel version 4.2 at least. So it's very common. So, I guess if you use some Kali Linux, there shouldn't be any problem with it. Same requirements as Blue Hydra, for instance. So it's the only problem you can have with the setup is the setup of the Noble and Blino libraries, which on some machines are very difficult to install. Depends on the node setup and the NPM tool. Other questions? No? Thank you for listening.